Thank you very much, Assad and World Affairs Council and Kevin and Marlboro College. I just want to start by saying I had a great time figuring out what to talk about tonight and how to talk about it to a group of people that I assume are not particularly wonky the way so many people in Washington are. So one thing that I did is I changed the title a little bit. It's still headed in the same direction as the title that was advertised, to a better globalization. We are all global citizens. So let me say a word about the Center for Global Development beyond what Kevin said. Our mission is to reduce poverty and inequality in the world, but we work on it in a very special way. We focus not on what developing countries should do, but on what the rich world should do, particularly the U.S., of course, but also the big, powerful international institutions, the European Union, the United Nations, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and so on. And I do think it's fair to say that we're the only ones that actually monitor the big guys. I should add, you know, in principle, kind of the corporate world and so on. So we're not advising developing countries or telling them what to do. We're telling our country what to do. So that's kind of where I want to come to at the end, that you can help tell our country what to do about poverty and development. Let me start with just so you get a sense of, this is something called the Commitment to Development Index. It's an annual product that the center puts out that ranks rich countries according to their policies in a whole range of issues that affect developing countries and poor people. So aid is there, but actually far more important, and I think more on our minds these days, is environment, primarily climate, where what we do has huge effects elsewhere, and migration and trade. There are 27 countries in the index. I think it's kind of unfortunate that the United States, even before the start of the Trump administration, was already number 20 out of 27. And in particular, on some issues like environment, ranks quite low. Same with migration, not as high as one would think. Let's put it that way. I want to say on this that I won't be talking about aid, and that in fact, evidence where people try to account for what really matters for most people in the developing world in terms of rich country policies, the evidence is that aid is actually a minor player. So development has to be thought of more and more as about a lot more than foreign aid. It's about the policies, trade, climate, sharing of technology, that sort of thing. That's what it's really about. So that gives you a sense, as did Kevin in his introduction, of where I'm coming from. I'm a development advocate, and I'm a globalist. And for those of us who are globalists, who recognize the reality that we live in many ways in one world, this is a dark and tough moment. There's no question about it. It's a dark moment for liberals and social activists, and it's a dark moment in this country, I think, for defenders of democracy. I'm not going to talk about all that. I'm going to talk about it's a dark moment, or I'm going to just, you know, as an introduction say, it is a tough moment for globalists, including development advocates. It's a tough moment if you worry about how to imagine or how to achieve better lives for almost 4 billion people, almost all in the developing world, who live on no more every day than $3 or less, which compares to, does anyone know, median income in the U.S., daily income? It's probably $50 or $60. So they're living on a lot less in material terms. Okay, So that's the dark moment slide. Headlines in 2016, Brexit, Trump's wall at the Mexican border, the rhetoric of fascism rising in the U.S. and in Europe, U.S. isolationism putting global stability at risk. So I've emphasized with these headlines the economic side of it somewhat, security and economics. So the risk with the Trump administration's approach of America first, which is translated into a sort of quasi-isolationism and protectionism, is troubling. And one reason it's troubling is that despite all the mistakes of the U.S. over the last 6 or 7 decades, mistakes like Vietnam, like Iraq, the fact is that the U.S. has taken the lead in creating a stable global order, which has fostered growth, among other good things, security at home, security abroad, and it certainly fostered global development. The U.S. was behind the creation of NATO and the United Nations, delivered peace to war-torn Europe, end of colonialism across Africa and Asia, defeat of communism as a freedom-destroying ideology, and so on. And with John Maynard Keynes, the U.S., who was representing the British, the U.S., in Bretton Woods, New Hampshire, just a few hours' drive from here, created the economic institutions that are part of this global architecture that has brought peace and stability and development to so much of the world. The World Health Organization, the World Bank, and so on. Even with all their shortcomings, they've been a huge net plus for the rest of the world and have helped bring amazing development progress in Asia, Africa, Latin America, and other developing regions. Much more than most people understand. Huge reductions in infant mortality, increases in life expectancy. Now almost all children at least get to go to primary school. The problem is they're not learning very much, but that's another thing. We have now a global norm around things like human rights and women's rights that some of my colleagues at the center are beginning to show itself makes a difference, that global norms sometimes get translated into laws in countries, and those laws, even when poorly enforced, gradually help change the norm. So it's a far better world than many people realize in terms of development progress. Many of you may have read the book of Steven Pinker, The Better Angels of Our Nature, who talks a lot about how much progress there's been, that life is just better for millions of people. So U.S. hard and soft power for 70 years has contributed to that reality. So it's a problem if we don't sustain that kind of leadership. And it's a tough moment. The Trump administration creates a kind of tough moment for those of us who advocate for these kinds of that kind of continued progress. Okay, all that is sort of background to 3 points I want to make. Oh, I should say, Kevin is going to tell me in about 15 minutes, well, even 10, you got to finish, so there's time for people to talk. Okay. So the first point is that for the U.S. and other mature democracies, market-driven globalization has been a two-edged sword. So that aspect of globalism, market-driven globalization, has been a two-edged sword. But whatever in whatever form, it is here to stay in some form, right? That's my first point. So there's some truth in the view that the cross-border movement of goods and capital has contributed to net loss of jobs in U.S. and Europe's market-driven mature economies. In fact, what is extraordinary is that the entry of something like 700 million new workers, mostly from China, but also from India and elsewhere, in the early 1980s, into the global market has happened without a lot more disruption. That's the miracle in a way. Still, the fact is that increased trade with China and other developing countries is a little bit of a villain in some of the problems that we're facing in the U.S. today. Loss of manufacturing jobs, I'd say in particular increased inequality with the top 1% and the top 0.1% having accumulated just immense amounts of wealth that's now beginning to, or has been, sort of affecting the politics of policy making. So, and has hurt, these things have hurt the working class, as we're all hearing about and reading about in the last 6 months, with the rise of populism and the xenophobic, anti-nativist, or nativist treatment of immigrants and so on. But it's also true for a development economist like me that this market-driven globalization, trade and capital flows among nations, has had huge benefits. There's no way to deny it. For the now six of seven billion people in the developing world, more open trade has helped people rise above the really miserly poverty line of now $1.90 a day. $3 is the median. $1.90 is the poverty line. Depending on how you think about poverty, I mean, I think $3 is still fundamentally, they're too poor, but it's definitely had a good effect. The access of Chinese workers to the U.S., huge U.S. consumer market, has meant jobs for them and brought hundreds of millions out of poverty. It's increased the size of the middle class across the developing world. And the middle class is a bulwark of democracy and respect for citizens' rights, and ultimately brings us more stability in those countries, which is good for everybody. The middle class is now 40% to 60% of the population in countries like Brazil, Chile, Poland. It's 60% of the urban population in China now. And it's 30% even in countries like Tunisia. Of course, it's tiny in poorer countries. Among the less tangible benefits, in most developing countries, globalization has meant the spread of ideas, and I referred to sort of the growing respect for women's rights as one example, and for the idea that everyone deserves an education, and for the idea of democracy, and so on. Moreover, economists have shown that it is not primarily trade that has destroyed manufacturing jobs in the U.S., but increased mechanization. Consider ATMs for bank tellers. Where have I got this? Consider ATMs destroying bank teller jobs, and now robotization, and soon greater and greater use of artificial intelligence, as in a future with many more driverless trucks and many fewer truck driving jobs. The fact is that manufacturing now produces 30% of US GDP, but produces only 8% of all jobs. The fact is that there's been a 50-year gradual secular decline in the number of manufacturing jobs, even as manufacturing has contributed still 30% to GDP. So what's happened is it's been mechanized, and that technological change is likely to continue. That's the way it is. I don't know how many people realize the number of workers in agriculture in the U.S., the percentage, students, yeah?
Two to 3%,
right. And pretty much everybody else works in services. including construction, of course, but also childcare and education and health and so on. So higher tariffs on imports are not going to arrest what is a long-term, inevitable phenomenon. Indeed, raising tariffs risks reducing jobs because of the phenomenon that economists call cross-border supply chains, meaning that manufacturing jobs in Tennessee rely on low-cost imports of auto parts from Mexico, which keep manufacturing jobs in Tennessee because automobiles made in Tennessee can compete with automobile jobs, with automobiles made in Germany and elsewhere. So that's the world we live in. I don't think, for this reason alone, the Trump administration can engineer more than a modest increase in trade protectionism without, in fact, destroying more manufacturing jobs than it is able to create. Trade itself is not, in other words, the main villain of the peace, you could say, in terms of market-driven globalization, nor is immigration the villain. Indeed, on the contrary, my colleagues at CGD have shown that ending the one-time bracero program that some of you might have heard of that permitted U.S. employers to hire Mexican workers temporarily in the 1930s and 40s did not have the intended effect of more jobs, of having Americans substitute, creating jobs for Americans once the bracero Mexicans left. And that, in general, immigration has been and still is a net economic plus for the U.S., even in those narrow economic terms with entrepreneurial immigrants, creating businesses and contributing to job creation for Native Americans. And except in the very short run and very in localized communities, all this at no fiscal costs, indeed, with fiscal benefits. It is only workers who have not completed high school that have lost jobs to immigrants. In my view, and only a little bit, lost jobs and wages, maybe 3% lower, it's estimated, than otherwise. And that, to me, is an indictment more of the failures of social policy in the U.S. than of immigration itself. And like cross-border trade, international migration is not going away. It may be restricted, but legal restrictions amount in the long run to putting one's finger in the dike when the flood tide is rising, given the huge gap in income between rich and poor countries. It is still, at least in some terms, better, in material terms, better to be in the poorest 10% of the U.S. population than in the richest 10% of the population in China, India, Ethiopia, etc. It's hard for people to believe it, but it is true. And keep in mind, the moment a Nigerian or a Haitian taxi driver arrives in the U.S., his or her expected income rises at least tenfold. For a Mexican, I don't know the exact amount, but it's more like 3 to 4-fold. And we see that with the pressures now. Of course, the Syrians is a different issue, who are escaping conflict. But continuing pressure, especially in Europe now, emigration from Africa. Finally, I want to say something about what is a problem with market-driven globalization, which is footloose capital. The mobility of capital, particularly in financial form, I'm not talking about foreign investment, but, you know, stock market, bonds, Wall Street, all of that. Inadequately regulated, what can be called financial globalization, has come at far higher costs across the whole world for everybody than trade and immigration. That's my point, in a way. among other things, it makes it very hard to, the global market makes it hard to tax capital. So countries compete with each other in order to attract capital by reducing taxes on capital. And that means, in effect, higher taxes on workers, on labor. But this is something that I'll come back to in a few moments. Let's go, I think, to my second point. The problem can be thought of as a global economy without a democratic global polity. And I'm going to use as examples taxes again and climate change. So there's a downside to globalization, at least in the US. That can be fixed with better domestic policies, frankly, I think. But there is a downside, and better domestic policies is not the subject of my talk tonight. Although, please, you're welcome to ask about them if you're interested in my view as an economist. But there are other broader downsides that are harder to deal with associated with globalized markets. Among them, say, you know, commercial pressures in a global market in the agricultural industry, for example, that lead to destruction of forests in Indonesia and Brazil and in other heavily forested countries, because consumers want, you know, oil palm and products that you need soybeans for and so on. And that pressure almost always comes in the form of some corruption in countries, especially Indonesia, much less so now Brazil, which has a larger middle class that's fighting with this thing. But Indonesia and other places in Asia and Africa where, you know, it's pretty easy to just bribe an official for a license or ignore the fact that you need a license in order to go in and burn down acres and acres, hectares of land. So we also have problems in oil and natural resource commodities, also creating, you know, the sowing deep seeds of corruption in places like Angola and Nigeria. And, you know, it's oil that has destroyed, in effect, democracy and brought huge costs to people in Venezuela. It's because of the fight over oil and the concentration of income and power there associated with having oil. So one way to think about, so these are global, these are created by a global market, and in many cases they become globally shared problems. One way to think about the problem is repeating, we have a tightly knit global economy without a global government to manage, to regulate, to use taxes as incentives or disincentives to behavior, but basically to manage the system in a manner that respects the interests with trade-offs of everyone in the world. Taking into account, for example, with democratic dialogue and compromise, the trade-offs of different policies for different constituents. That's never going to happen. We can't really do democracy at the global level. Although my husband is thinking, well, maybe we could on the internet. That's what he thinks about and works on. So we don't have the equivalent of a social contract at the global level. There isn't any global social contract at all. So we have a global economy without good global politics. Let me go back to the example of taxes. Because it's easy to move money across borders, it is harder for countries, even the US, to tax financial capital than to tax labor. Repeating myself. It must be time, Kevin. 5 minutes? I'm getting there. The US and Europe have not been able to agree even on shared rules to limit tax evasion. The Brits want to keep, you know, Canary Islands because they have powerful people that have powerful interests in the Canary Islands, and so on and so on. So the U.S. likes to have the Cape. Certain people in the U.S. like to have the Cayman Islands and other places where they can hide their money. Nigeria and Angola, to go back to those countries, for years, corrupt politicians, even the leadership, would send their capital to Swiss banks, and Swiss banks didn't want to and still don't want to reveal who has their money because they make money on that money. So what is bad for richer countries? All these things like that with capital are far worse for poorer countries in lost revenue to provide really basic education and build roads and bridges and so on. Another more obvious example is climate change. U.S. emissions per capita are higher than that of any other country. You and I are inflicting on poor people in India and Ethiopia and Bangladesh now terrible costs and loss of livelihoods due to drought, sea level rise, extreme weather, forced migration resulting from these problems. New York City spent something like $3 billion cleaning up after Superstorm Sandy. That is the entirety of the Obama administration commitment or pledge made to an international organization called the Green Climate Fund, which is meant for a three-year period, so $1 billion a year, amounting to $3 billion, that is supposed to be used in part to help developing countries become more resilient to and adapt to climate change. With the Trump administration, you know, my fear would be that even that penurious pledge will not be honored fully or honored. Still another is the tragically poor management of growing flows of migration across countries. It's another global problem. Now we have refugees that the world needs to think of as creating problems for everybody of security and so on, as well as, you know, being in human terms a terrible thing. But as a world, we have no tools. Even the Europeans, with their European Union, don't have a tool to enforce burden sharing amongst themselves on how to take care of and allow to stay refugees and immigrants. So let me go to number three and finish. In defense of responsible cosmopolitanism, we are all global citizens. So I wanted to say cosmopolitanism because it's kind of provocative. You think of it, and many of I do too, in a way, as associated with the sort of jet set Manhattanite elite that interacts with the elite in London and Mumbai and so on, but it's this whole separate society from working people, salaried people in their own countries. But in fact, the roots of the term are really just about the idea of a community, a cosmos, in which there are certain values that are shared, certain approach in terms of morals to the world that's shared. I think an easier term is global citizen, citizens of the world. World value surveys, which are done in over 100 countries every 5 years or so, show that over the last 10 years, in most countries, more than 70% of people consider themselves both citizens of the world and, of course, citizens of their own country. A surprisingly small number of people see a contradiction in that. You can both be a patriot and be a globalist. One of the things I wanted to show is this is true even in developing countries, there has been a tremendous increase in awareness that we're in a global system. This shows civil society involvement, non-governmental organizations that work on international issues and have registered with the United Nations. It shows their growth for the whole world, and then it shows the huge growth in Asia and Africa in the last 20, 25 years. And that's gone with the internet and, you know, changes, mobile money, all kinds of things are going on that, in effect, make everybody more and more aware that what happens in one country affects people in other countries. Even what happens, as I said, for Indonesia and Brazil is affecting us in the U.S. because they're contributing with forest burning to climate change. And the same is true of coal, more and more coal being produced in India especially and China. So that brings me to the conclusion. Well, this is just to show you that rise in civil society contrasts with the steady number of many fewer official international institutions like the UN and the World Bank and the IMF and so on. So let me end with just a word. Skip 2016, which was a tough year. Think back to September 2015. Over 150 countries agreed on 17 sustainable development goals. And many targets and indicators, you can roll your eyes. You know, easy to agree, we're going to do this. We're going to have universal education. We're going to have to eliminate poverty by 2030. We're going to reduce inequality in the world. We're going to reduce inequality amongst developing countries. Still, that was reflecting a kind of sense of global citizenry. And maybe more important, in December 2015, the same number, 150 or more countries, forged the Paris Agreement on climate change, at least agreeing there is a serious problem and that every country bears some responsibility. It's unenforceable because it's voluntary, but it's a step in the right direction. Let's go back to the chart where the U.S. ranked only number 20 of 25, one of the richest, most powerful countries in the world. As global citizens, and if you're in Kevin's course, you must be a globally minded citizen, we in the U.S. have a special responsibility to fight for that global agenda. The Sustainable Development Goals and the Paris Agenda, and put America not only first. Don't let me say that. Resist the policies that put America not only first, but only about America. And to push on moral grounds and in our own enlightened self-interest what will make for a more stable and secure world. For U.S. policies here that would improve the U.S.'s ranking in the Commitment to Development Index. Thank you very much.
As usual, we welcome any questions that you may have. We are about...
Or complaints. Concerns.
Complain, your knees are in danger. Do not complain. We love you. We love to have any question that you have, and given there are 55 people, there may be many questions. So please make your question very clear and very brief, so we can address as many possible. Yes, sir.
My name is Cyrus, and my question was about self-interest. You know, a lot of people who analyze voters in many countries find that they vote against their self-interest, and so. The vote on Brexit, for example, at some layered level, it seemed like people who were voted against didn't realize that by leaving the EU, they might hurt their quality of life and might damage the quality of life of all people in the UK. So how can we ever get to a point of countries working together better, having a more global polity, when majorities do things against the self-interest and break apart any global connections that are forming, like the EU?
I guess that's why I work at a think tank. You know, I think that sharing facts and evidence with people more, as much as possible, in the end, it has to have some good effect. It may not eliminate the kind of issue you're raising where, and we don't really know in the case of Brexit, and we don't really know in the case of many policies in the U.S. that are passed that may not seem to be in the interests of the people who voted for the politicians that are pushing those policies. So I think we're just back to the broader conversation that you're probably all thinking about, facts and evidence. If anyone else has a suggestion.
We have a question again. Yes. Yeah.
How do you reconcile development, which is depends upon growth, with the fact that we live on a finite planet, where some economists argue that at best we should be in a steady state system or even in a degrowth system?
How do you reconcile?
Paraphrase the questions, because it isn't always clear depending on where you sit.
Sure. The question is how to reconcile growth with the reality that we seem to be destroying the natural resources on which growth in the long run depends. I think it's a really, you know, it's not straightforward. I think it's possible, frankly.
Well, can you have development without growth?
There's economic, well, let me start by saying in terms of goals like reducing poverty in the developing world, the evidence is incontrovertible. Without growth in those countries, you do not get poverty reduction. I mean, growth is necessary. It's certainly not sufficient, but it's necessary. So then we come to your point. If growth depends on, you know, fossil fuels and jobs in the coal industry, if getting electricity to millions of people in India depends on coal, then we're all in trouble in the long run, right? If burning up the forests in order to generate jobs in Indonesia, it's not going to work. So, you know, in a way, that's why climate is something that people are more aware of now, but you're right on the larger sense that it's a problem. Now, I think we can have growth in well-being, maybe not in always, you know, 5%, 10% income growth a year in the richest world or for the richest people. We can. But it does require a lot of the sort of management and the equivalent of a global social contract around minimizing bad things than we're very close to. So, you know, I think that's not a simple answer. I mean, one of the good things that's happened in the last 20 or 30 years is that development economists have pushed better measures of what is well-being, better accounting. Let's not count in GDP, sort of the security apparatus, you know, all those TSA people in our airports, they are not contributing in any general sense to greater well-being. And yet their jobs and their income is included in GDP growth. And there's hundreds of examples like that. So a little step on the way is to have better accounting. And there's a lot of discussion around in the UN and in the World Bank about how to get there. Then GDP style accounting is just a product of the late 30s and 40s. 1930s and 40s. There is no reason why we can't imagine a world in which a different kind of account would make sense.
On that note, I was wondering if there's an indicator that you're personally really pushing for in opposition to GDP, if there's something that you're in support of. And I had another question regarding the sort of vision of a global polity in regards to a global climate policy. I've read some remarks you made about how the dialogue needs to shift from sort of emissions accounting to sort of reanalysis of how countries use energy, and I was wondering if you could expand a bit on what that policy would look like.
Okay, I'll just give it an example. Try. So on the first question, So the first question was, is there a better measure in your view than GDP? Well, I can't answer that well.
It's HDI.
The Human Development Index is not very good. GDP per capita is one third of it. Life expectancy is a good measure. I'm a proponent, there's a big discussion of how to measure what to count as poverty. It should go beyond income. I mentioned median income in developing countries of $3 a day. That's a really bad measure. Many people say, well, you should measure life expectancy, and changes in that, and education, so on and so on. I don't think the solution to it is a magic one around one indicator. I have a colleague who does well-being, does surveys of happiness. Are you happy? Do you enjoy life satisfaction? And some of the results from that indicate anomalies, where people that are having greater income in places like Afghanistan and Peru are more frustrated because their expectations have risen and they want even more. So, we're human beings. I think we have to sort of live with a variety of measures that give us a big picture. Those individual measures we can do much better on. No single measure pops into my mind. Now, your second question was about energy, what to do about the energy.
Emissions, how we sort of currently intergovernmentally try to attempt to...
Right.
Climate plan.
So I think the best single example of that, and it's a small example, but it's an interesting one because many people think of the IMF as really sort of bad news, right, the International Monetary Fund. But in the last 10 years, the IMF has done a huge amount of work on the externalities, that one country that's burning fossil fuel is imposing on other countries. And on the problem that in many countries rich in fossil fuel, there's a tendency to actually subsidize gasoline, for example. And once they start subsidizing gasoline, we tax it here, at least. Maybe not enough, but we tax it. In countries like Nigeria, all over the developing world, where countries have oil, they subsidize it. So it's really perverse, right? So the IMF has done a tremendous amount of work, and they have it in their agenda with every country. It's a major goal, at least end fossil fuel subsidies. Stop subsidizing fuel. When you subsidize fuel, not only are you adding to the problem of climate change, within your country, you're subsidizing the rich who use a lot more fuel at the cost of the poor. So it's another kind of inequality.
Okay, the next question.
Well, when I think about resources, the allocation of resources in the United States, for example. I heard there are two people willing to pay $200 million to fly around the moon. And my friend's son was finishing his internship or residency as an orthopedic surgeon. Where was he taking it? he was on the football team at the University of Southern California. Now, certainly there must have been other people that needed his skills more than these kids going to college. And it seems to me that our one goal in this country as individuals is to make money. And are we ever going to get above 20 if we only have that as our goal? Because we are amassing wealth individually to a really ludicrous amount.
Well, I think, let me just say, in this country, there are a lot of policies that are exacerbating our problem of income inequality. But we are never going to have, you know, everybody with the same income.
No.
Okay. I don't think it's intrinsically a bad thing for people to want to be productive, get life satisfaction, make money. The question is, what is it that makes it problematic? That tends to be some set of policies that, you know, taxes could be more progressive, we could spend more on higher education, we could deal better with our healthcare system, we could be more like, you know, the Finns and the, we could be more like Denmark and Finland and Sweden and all those countries that also people are making a lot of money. I guess I don't go completely with the premise of your question that it's necessary to undo the natural instinct of people to make money.
We have one question here, and then
except maybe through your tax system, where they, so.
Okay.
Is it one here?
Yeah.
Your question.
Can you comment on other values which are operationalized, maybe not the primary one of making money, they're there. Someone has told the second bottom line, as the social results of corporations, things like that, which show that there are other values besides making money that show themselves in capitalism and could be encouraged in capitalism. Do you have any comment on the extent to which that you feel that exists or could exist?
Yeah, I mean, I'm uncomfortable with the way I answered your question, so let me try to fix it by answering your question. Is there anything going on in the sort of productive market economy that is taking us more in the direction of, it's not just about money, it's about broader goals, it's more about the sustainable development goals for everybody, different values? Yes, there's a lot of effort. Sometimes it's for reasons of public, you know, public affairs in the corporate world to do better. But there's also, I mean, we have an annual award to someone in the rich world at the center who's made a difference in attitudes or behavior in the his or her country that's helped developing countries. So one year we had Paul Polman, who's the head of the food, big food company. I can't believe I can't remember the name of it.
Nestle's, well?
No, not Nestle's, but the other one.
Conagra?
One of those. A big Unilever. Which is a Dutch-based corporation. Maybe not a coincidence. We think of the Dutch as, you know, being having more other values besides money. Anyway, Unilever and Kellogg's and others have signed, you know, a pledge and are doing it to not source stuff that they need to make their cosmetics and cereals and soaps and all kinds of stuff from wood that's traded by those in countries like, I keep mentioning Indonesia, but it's Guyana and, you know, in the forested world. If they, you know, are not operating legally. And many more of those traders now have the intermediary that buys, right, to sell to Unilever and others. Many more of those traders are now signing up that they're not going to buy bad stuff. So, you know, the issue is, can this make a difference? I think it can. You know, it's not always easy. Counter to that, we have things like in the U.S., the Congress has just sort of backed off from an SEC regulation that was basically an anti-bribery clause, you know, that said if you're an American, if you raise money on the U.S. stock market, you must report to the SEC all payments to foreign governments that you make when you're going around producing oil or looking for copper or minerals and so on. So, you know, it's like that's going in the wrong direction. And it's making, in a way, reminding us that the corporate world is sometimes complicit in corruption through bribery in countries where it's very costly in the end for people. At the same time, there are other corporations that, particularly those that generate consumer products that you buy, who want to behave better, among other reasons, so that you'll keep buying their products. So I think there is a change in, you know, the changed rules that are agreed upon can change norms. Changed norms can spread to changed values. And you're all sitting here asking about natural resources, so obviously, well, it's Marlboro and Brattleboro. You have values that go well beyond making more money. So, thank you for the question.
Okay.
My question was pretty similar because I thought your talk was very refreshing for an economist, that it wasn't just economic models, but that the value system was the third and final point, right? But I was wondering, how lonely are you in the world of economists? Kind of ruling the world from my point of view, and to what extent could compassion, for example, be a criterion for decision making?
Oh, I'm not lonely at all. You know, I think that development economists are more interested in the kinds of issues that we're talking about tonight than your average economist. That microeconomists, for students who know the distinction, are likely to be more interested, and people who work in applied economics and empirical work than are macroeconomists who work with models and theories and so on. But no, I'm not lonely. And if anything, what I've seen over the last 15 years, even at the Center for Global Development, is a huge increase in the number of economists getting their PhDs who want to come to the center to do a postdoc because they want to have some exposure to the policy world. They want to do research that has policy relevance, and they want to do it in an area like development. So, better angels of our nature.
Yes, sir. You have that. You have, and then after that, sir, and then your sir.
Have you ever really tried to engage with those views which are maybe against you or against World Bank and IMF? Because what we hear is really, I'm from the poorest country, and I'm really dissatisfied, to be honest. And have you ever critiqued? Because what you say is that there was change, gain. We can say that there is retaliation as the policy from World Bank, IMF, and all UN agencies is really not really satisfied. Have you been or accepted such criticism? Because we are in 21st century.
Right.
We have to believe that things are not right. And if, still going to push that this policy, because if you tell me that there's a democracy, I mean, it's in your paper, that there is change. I mean, we hear that people are dying, killing each other, and the World Bank is there.
I think
have you ever engaged with your critics and because we know that you are powerful. World Bank is powerful, IMF is powerful.
Okay,
sometimes they need to stop and discuss, or maybe we can disagree, but the reality is reality. All the turmoil, all the problem today we see is really, I mean, if there is a change, we go upward. But it's only on, maybe only on.
Okay, let us summarize your question.
I'm trying to make sure I understand your question also. I think you're saying, have I, and you know, people that work with me, do we ever talk to people from the countries?
Have different view. Have you just, because there are a lot of publications and
okay, so research. What is your question?
Have you ever engaged, have you ever reflected back on what you have done? When I say you, sorry, it's not you, but the World Bank or the IMF.
I see.
All the UN.
The
impact of the policy.
Right.
Yes.
The impact of the policy.
World Bank policy.
Who's looking at the impact of the countries that it's set up to be?
Yes.
Could you slowly repeat the question?
Yes. Have I and others like me, do we look back and ask and assess whether the policies of institutions like the World Bank are doing any good? Are they doing more harm than good? Yes, the answer is yes. there was a wave of sort of economic literature, thinking, writing about what were called the structural adjustment policies of the World Bank. Did they do good or ill? Did they undermine countries' ability? When the IMF goes and says you have to cut your budget, is that undermining, you know, the ability of a government to deliver basic health care, et cetera, et cetera? You can go on the websites of those institutions and find constant looking back evaluations. You can go on our website and find a report done by a working group headed by a former IMF staff person who looked at the effect of IMF programs during the tough times when the IMF was pushing, you know, reduce your deficit, spend less, you're spending too much on civil servants, you know, that's all patronage, blah, 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 not effective. Looking back in African countries, I don't know if you're from Africa, you might be. And the conclusion was that the IMF overdid it. That the IMF failed to understand if it says to a country like Zambia, cut your budget across, that the Zambians will cut it across the board. They won't cut it in a way that protects really basic services for people. So the IMF now, in every consultation, they call them Article 4 consultations, 15 years later, 10 years later, they say every consultation has to consider if there are budget cuts, how you preserve the safety net, how you make to set priorities, et cetera. That's just one example. hundreds of these. Now, it's never going to be perfect because these institutions have money and power. That's the reality. So one of the things that we do at the center is studies and reports like the one I just mentioned to hold the feet, their feet to the fire in those institutions.
We have
but time. It's never going to be perfect.
We have time for three good questions. You're number two, number one, and then the third one. Yes, right there. But I just wanted to make one comment regarding the last question. In the year I was in Wall Street, where every company was audited by two or three auditing companies, everybody said, why the World Bank, IMF, is not being audited? And that has been a good question, and I will ask that question later on, not tonight. It's just they did not want to be audited. That is what we asked them. But that's another word. So we have a question from Mr. Assad Ahlavi. Go ahead.
So in the world of politics today, in the world of politics today, what's happening in the world, there's so much war going on. And most of these wars, I believe, are mostly on oil and gas. What's happening in Afghanistan, what's happening in Iraq, Persian Gulf, Libya, all these countries, these powerful countries going to destabilize those countries to stabilize themselves in the long term. That's what their goal is. And there are lots of refugees and immigrants coming and going to different countries. So what is your takeaway? What do you think would this immigration would, how can we help? What would the, forgot the question. Are you more optimistic or pessimistic? What would happen in the near future or in the long term?
With respect to conflict in poor countries, especially those with oil.
Yeah, global economy.
Oh.
About war, destabilizing those poor, poor countries,
well, the
trying to stabilize themselves.
It feels...
Could we repeat the question once again?
Right. What's my... am I optimistic or pessimistic about more or fewer conflicts in the world, especially in the developing world? Well, the evidence is that despite everything we read and hear about, fewer people are dying because of conflicts within and among countries than in the 20th century, than in the 1980s, than in the trajectory is good. Some of what your question reflects is likely far greater access to information about conflict in Somalia, in Afghanistan, in, you know, northeast India, and so on and so on, in Nepal, that many people never really knew about. So on the basis of that long-run trend, I remain optimistic.
Okay, that's good.
Are you okay?
Yes,
sir.
It would seem that the overall health of the world would be best served with fewer people in terms of natural resources, etc. But on the other hand, it seems as though American capitalism, driven by the bottom line, and somehow there not being any kind of cap on how much money American capitalism wants to earn, they're dependent upon consumers. Consumers is a bigger population. I would think American capitalism would not be happy to see a decrease in world population. What's the relationship between American capitalism and wanting more consumers, more people?
I have never thought about this question because for the next 50 years at least, there will not be any decrease in the number of people in the world.
There will not be much.
Decrease in
income. Population will continue to grow for at least another 50 years. So
why can't it be addressed, population growth? Why doesn't anybody want to talk about it or do anything?
Do you think that's a bad thing?
Oh.
That's the question.
Well, I think if we had more effort to empower women, then we would have women having fewer children. So I'm not a big proponent of going around and pushing that people have fewer children. We know that doesn't work very well. People want fewer children when there's more opportunities for education of their children, when they have more money, frankly, you know, and they have more interest, more ability to consume in other ways besides having children. When they see a good future for their children, and they want to focus on investing in a few children instead of having a lot. So it's hard for me to answer your question because I've been surprised, frankly, by the extent to which Ethiopia has managed to improve the lives of people, despite the fact that 30 years ago, when it had sort of 15 million people, it looked like a catastrophe that it was going to have 100 million people 50 years later. But it does. So it's kind of scary because when you have that kind of population growth, countries have to have really good policies in order to ensure sufficient growth of the economy so that all these people have jobs and income, and so on and so on. So it's kind of like that. I don't think I'm answering your question, but I'm not a proponent of pushing people to have fewer children. I am a proponent of ensuring reproductive rights for every woman, partly because that's a right, in my view, for women, and partly because when those women are empowered and have control over when, as much as how many babies to have, they will change their communities for the better, that will change their countries for the better, and that will be good for the world.
Jane? Yes. This is the last question tonight because of timing. Those of you who have other questions, please do write it to us, and we will get the answer for you and send it to you.
Maybe.
We are sorry. Well, we will make an answer. But you will have an answer. So, please.
I have sort of a two-part thing. This last question is one part of my concern is that if there's policies developed for the understanding that our resources are finite on the globe, that even private companies, but government policies that improve water and the management of water, because this is a very urgent thing, and that the distribution of the energy resources in such a way, so if there's more immigration to China, to help them grow their energy industry, that some of the decisions about Africa are to help them develop their resources for their continent, because just the example of the last 20 years where they jumped right over the old telephone to the internet and the phone makes a big difference. So that global policies and helping people to understand that if the management of the resources and water and infrastructures are more global, that naturally the population in issue and pressures will reduce, because as countries get more affluent and more accessible to the resources that you need for controlling things, they have fewer babies. This is known from research in Northern Europe and that kind of thing, that people will learn to manage their lives in a better way. And secondly, my first question was, I'm more concerned about Brexit and what that has done to the breakup of Europe. Back in the 60s, I was very involved in the beginning of the Atlantic Treaty and the whole coal and steel thing and the different things that were helping Europe after the war to build policies that would support each other. And to see people not understand about the response of the global responsibility and therefore retracting to what they think was going on in their lifestyle, you know, that keeping borders and all that are very important, is just a real threat, because if all these fall apart, we're never going to get global responsibility.
Okay, so I think you make some really good points. The first point I think was, are we helping countries help themselves? Are we sharing with them the kinds of policies that work, for example, in management of water?
Right.
Are we in the global system, you know, world back to the World Bank and the IMF and the UN and all that? And, you know, the straightforward answer is yes. I mean, but it's always, just as it's politically tough here to address water management policies in a way that makes sense. I mean, look at the situation in California, you know, where they're still growing rice, the last time I went there visiting cousins. And, you know, and they're growing rice, which is an incredibly water-intensive crop, because they have guaranteed rights to a certain amount of irrigation. And that irrigation, then it doesn't reach the rest of California, and certain, you know, the Colorado River doesn't go to Mexico anymore. So, every polity, every political system, every country, every national system, just as at the local level, has trouble getting to political agreement on policies that have costs for some people. Benefits for everybody on average, but high costs for some people, often powerful vested interests. So it's a struggle on all of these things, like water management. It's a struggle on technology transfer. You know, on the one hand, we have the Gates Foundation pushing to get more vaccines and more medicines that would address the needs of the poorest people. We had the U.S. Doing a fantastic job in the national health, what's it called, you know, where they push to find the drugs that would keep people dying from AIDS. And that transformed the situation in Africa, frankly. And U.S. taxpayers financed that under the Bush administration. So these issues are not necessarily partisan. But there's always more. It can always be better. So, you know, that technology transfer was one of the components of the way we rank rich countries. Do they help or not? So that's why we need all of you fighting for better policies and better programs and better values and all of that as global citizens. I don't know if I answered your question, Gina.
The second one was about Brexit.
Yeah, it goes back to one of the other questions. It wasn't that not in the interests of many people in the UK to vote for Brexit. And of course, many of us are asking, was it in the interests of that sort of base, Republican base, or whatever it is that elected, that went with Trump in the presidential election? Are the policies that the Trump administration is starting to implement good for those people? No, they're not good. I don't think so. So let's hope that they're punished in the next election that we have, that our democracy works, right? In the congressional elections in 2 years. And punished again in the next presidential election. So yeah, you know, making a better world is about democratic politics within countries and more equivalent of democratic politics across countries as well. Thank you all.
Thank you.